I guess we start now. So welcome to my talk. An introduction to ZFS, a solid foundation for your data. All I'm talking about today is about the Open ZFS project. So depending on whether you use Open ZFS or a commercial implementation by Sun or Oracle, there might be some differences. But since OpenZFS originally branched off the Oracle implementation, what I talk about today should apply to both. So maybe to give some motivation, let's think about what it means to actually store data on disks, because it's actually not a solved problem. Disks are spinning rust. They are faulty all the time, and most times you even don't notice. You can have phantom writes where this physical disk arm with the write head on top maybe moves slightly too far right, so it will overwrite data in a different track. There are many reports by the different disk manufacturers actually giving some statistical foundation to such problems. There's bit rot, so maybe radiation from space, and we don't know to what this could lead. You could have flaky power, for example, on your home NAS, on your laptop, and just drain its battery too quickly. And you will have to run FSCKs with traditional file systems after that to verify the integrity of the data structures on disk, which is very time consuming. Firmware bugs. Those shiny new SSDs, they have a lot of new code inside, and these bugs actually do occur. Then volume management. You think, well, I use SoftRate and LVM to mitigate all these problems. Volume management is just ugly on at least traditional volume management. There are exceptions, but in general, at least that's my impression, and I'll give an example on that soon. Disk partitioning, it's very, very inflexible. I assume almost anyone in the room here had or will have to someday resize a partition that just wasn't big enough, or there's a need to have another partition for something else. And this list could go on and on. I think we would find plenty examples. So an example on how to set up traditional, moderately redundant storage on Linux would be this, which is rather ugly. We'll walk through this. So we will create a SoftRate using the mdatom utility. The syntax is okay, but you have to learn it. So we create the MD0 virtual device. We name it MD0. We create a mirror with two devices, SDA1 and SDV. And this MD0 is exposed to LVM physical volumes. We create a LVM physical volume. We create a logical volume group on top of it. And then we create a logical volume of the size of 100 gigabytes, which will be exposed as devmapper VG0 root. And on this virtual block device, we create a X4 file system, which is a fairly standard setup enforced by many installers. So what layers are we putting together here? We have the kernel device driver, which exposes the raw block device in DevFS usually, and then we stick together some volume managers. So first mdatom, Linux SoftRate, and then LVM, and each of these layers exposes an interface similar to this one. So a virtual device, like in dev, dev MD0, dev VG0, dev VG0 minus root, and data on these virtual devices is addressable through an offset into the device. Fairly simple. And the beauty of this setup is that you can just put a file system on top of it, and the file system implementers will only have to worry about block addressable devices. And to the file system, all these disks you just stick together, they look like one contiguous big block device. Very easy for the implementers, but it comes with some significant drawbacks. In particular, the inflexibility we talked about. You have problems with or the aim of providing data integrity features isn't that simple to do in these setups. And to save some time, I think we can summarize. We could do better. We can do better, and I think we can do better. Certainly with ZFS. In ZFS, what we had in these slides, it's exactly one command. So we will disassemble this a little. Zpool is the tool to create a pool of storage. Zpool creates a pool of storage. Tank is the name of the pool, and what we want. What we want is a mirror of device SDA1 and SDB1, and that's basically all we're asking for. So maybe to have a look on how ZFS will present this to the user. Zpool status tank, very simple syntax, and we see we have this pool tank here. No problems reported, no scan requested so far, and it's composed of a mirror device grouping together SA1 and SDB2, no checksumming errors, as expected. So this may be as a little teaser how nice ZFS can be to the administrator. So the goal of this talk is not to give you 1 hour of command line examples, because I think I would fail dramatically at this, because command line examples are actually hard. I will give some in the end, but the goal of this talk is to give you an overview of how ZFS is designed internally, how key features are realized, and if you want to play with it practically, then you can visit the workshop. I will give a note about this later on. So, ZFS design goals. I basically copied them from the original paper from 2003, which are simple administration, pooled storage, and always consistent on disk state, and error detection and correction. We already saw the part about simple administration, and we already saw this pooled storage thing, but we'll go into that more detail later. So maybe the feature checkpoints, so to say, have many, many, many points. But I think the most important one, no FSCK whatsoever. With ZFS, you will not have this, because there is no need to have an FSCK if you somehow manage to have an always consistent on-disk state. You have a very simple administration interface and very powerful semantics inside. You can organize big storage systems into individual file systems. You have an inheritance model that is very flexible. You can delegate datasets to unprivileged users on your system, if you're not on Linux. Linux does not have this feature yet. You can delegate datasets to containers or zones, the Solaris thing, or JS in FreeBSD. So the administrator in the zone can create datasets inside, but not outside. Or this support for this is implemented fairly generically. You have disk-level redundancy. So as we already saw before, you can create mirrors, you can create RAID-like systems. We'll go into more details later on. You have data integrity, full stop, basically. Nothing on ZFS is not backed by the data integrity unit inside. So in an age where storage gets bigger and bigger and we use more disks, the probability that some bit will flip in your storage system becomes actually significant, and you might not want to risk that. And I think for the next year's data integrity will become even more important, and also on consumer systems, end user systems. ZFS gives you dynamically allocated POSIX file systems. You don't have the mess you have with LVM, or where you actually allocate 100 gigabytes of your virtual storage and have then a fixed partition on top of that. That's not how ZFS works. You have the pooled storage, and the file systems dynamically allocate storage from the pool. Of course, you still want to limit certain usage of file systems, so you can have quotas or reservations on these file systems. So for example, if you have a dedicated file system for log files, because you want to reserve certain space on your system to write log files, that's totally possible. So no drawbacks with a pool storage approach. You can have Z-vaults. Z-vaults essentially take all the data integrity and other features I explained here, and does not only apply these to file systems, but also to virtual storage devices. So like LVM, where you can just export another virtual block device, you can do that with ZFS too, but with all the key features of ZFS implemented on that as well. You have cheap, consistent copy-on-write snapshots and clones, and that's probably the selling point for ZFS beginners. You can solve many, many problems if you have fast snapshotting. So a key example for this would be system updates, where you want to freeze the state of the system quickly, then perform the upgrade and roll back to that state if something goes wrong during the upgrade. And you can take that even to a new level and say, well, I will snapshot the state of the system, fork this snapshot into a writable copy, perform the system update on the writable copy, and try to boot from the writable copy. And if this went well, I will just promote this writable copy, this clone, to be the new root file system. You can play with this feature later if you want. It's really impressive. These snapshots, they, of course, are not bound to the individual machine where the instance or this pool of ZFS runs. You can replicate snapshots via a pipe to another machine. So you could say, send the snapshot through this pipe, which might be an SSH connection, to your storage server somewhere else, and receive that snapshot there. And either you keep it as a stream dump file, or you pipe it back into the ZFS instance on the other side, and then you have replicated your file system. And this is way faster than rsync, and you actually have a consistent backup, because the snapshot is copied and not the live data an application might be working on. You have per data set configurable compression and deduplication, and these are other very nice to have features. In particular, the deduplication part is very important to certain applications. About the compression, maybe log files are quite repetitive, as you might know. So this system name in the beginning, for example, or if there is a log file that only contains the same string all over again, which should not happen, but it does, this is easily manageable by ZFS, and this won't produce much excess storage overhead. You can speed up pool operations with ZFS, because if you have an all HDD pool, then you're basically bound to the individual configuration of the pool and by the speed of the individual hard drives. So you can either try to stripe hard drives together and then mirror these. You can create complex setups. But what you can also do, is fasten up your I/O operations by designating devices to be read caches or write caches. And this is integrated in the ZFS. This is not some crazy hack like flash cache on Linux. And finally, variable block size, often underestimated feature, but it's actually very nice that you can adjust the block size of your individual file system to the workload you have on the file system. So for example, if you have large files, that are read in a stream-like fashion. So for example, a movie streaming server, then you might go with very large block sizes to save overhead in the metadata and housekeeping stuff. In contrast, when you have a database application, you might want very small block sizes. And this is totally doable on a single zpool. And I could continue on and on, but we are also already 40 minutes in, and the implementation chapter we are coming to right now will take a little bit longer. So again, an overview over the traditional layering. We already had that. We have the device driver in the lower part, which basically serves as a hardware abstraction, and it exposes the physical device via logical block addressing. You have the volume manager on top of this, or in case of the Linux demo I gave before, multiple volume managers stack together. And these all work, or mostly work, through logical block addressing all over again. It's virtual devices, but the interface doesn't change. And only on the very last part, the file system, it actually implements on this data formats. Before, it's dump block-based storage. And the file system exposes itself through the syscall interface to the application. So applications, I assume you are familiar with the standard C library for interfacing with files in this case. The applications themselves see files as offset addressable storage, or they can mount it as memory map, but let's stick with these standard codes for now. So the traditional on-disk format, or one example for a traditional on-disk format, is index-based allocation with inodes. So usually, this is meant to be a disk. I did my best in drawing with Inkscape. I hope you forgive my. this is a traditional, should be a traditional disk, and the file system usually keeps some headers spread over the disk to introduce to implement on disk redundancy, at least for a little bit, for the header structures. And then individual files are represented by inodes. And these inodes are a contiguous chunk of storage on the disk containing some basic metadata. So for example, the mode of the file, so whether it's executable, readable, writable, the owner of the file, so the actually user ID, the group ID, or the other metadata you're probably familiar with, and also information about how much bytes are actually stored in that file. Then, how the actual data is stored, you use levels of indirection for this, because you won't store the data alongside with the inode. Because inode itself stands for index, and you really don't want to have your index have variable length of data in the end. So what we do is we introduce a level of indirection. We have the direct blocks, and these point directly to data blocks on disk. So if we have very small files, which could fit in the first three or n direct blocks, then accessing byte 512, for example, would mean we walk through the list of direct blocks and just know, because we have a fixed block size, well, I need byte 512, and I have a 512 byte block size, so it won't be in the first block on disk, but in the second, it will be the first byte. So we walk through this list, look up this reference, and find the actual block on disk. Well, works. If you have very large files, then these direct block references won't suffice, and you will have single indirect, double indirect, or triple indirect block pointers. So what will happen is, for example, if we want to reference 1 megabyte, we walk through all these direct blocks, see this offset won't suffice, we walk into a single indirect block, dereference this block, and this block contains even more block pointers. So it contains the same information as stored in these three or four direct block pointer slots. So we walk to the correct address here. We can do computation, so this is fairly easy. And finally, we will dereference the appropriate block pointer, walk to the block on disk, fetch it again, and then we have our data block at 1 megabyte offset. So this is a very simple and understandable approach, but this all happens on the file system layer. So what if you had a second disk that is not addressable by inodes on the same disk? You have to find some solution to this. You can, of course, but it's not really the appropriate place in this format. So coming back to the traditional layering, we'll have a look on how ZFS is layered differently. As you might see here, we have more layers and differently named layers. Just want to give a quick note beforehand. These three layers are part of ZFS. The others, this one is in the kernel, and this one is the syscall interface, which is also part of the operating system and part of the kernel, but not part of ZFS. So we should focus on the interfaces between these different layers, because these are very different in ZFS. So on the lower part, you have the kernel device driver exposing the block device, then you have the storage pool allocator, which, as the name suggests, cares about pooling the storage you have available. And the way it does this is provide an interface similar to virtual memory exposed to applications. We'll come to that later on. But for now, it must suffice that we implement data virtual addresses that are not specific to any individual device. It's a bit like the SPA. If you give the SPA a digital data virtual address, it will look up the appropriate block on the appropriate disk. And it will, if you configure it to use disk redundancy, it will also care about this part. So if you give it a data virtual address, then it will resolve whether it's on the one mirror, or on the one side of the mirror, or the other side of the mirror, and hence you also need I/O orchestration in this particular layer. Next, the data management unit. It heavily leverages the storage pool allocator, because if we solve these redundancy problems, and later we will see also the checksumming problems in a lower layer, then the upper layers don't have to worry about this. Actually, very nice, because what the data management unit does is also complicated, because it implements an interface to the upper layers similar to how you interact with files in a regular C program. It exposes a flat object, and this is addressable through an offset. And the modifications you do to an object are kept in transactions. So the data management unit actually implements the on-disk integrity and on-disk consistency features of ZFS. And above the data management unit, we have the ZFS POSIX layer, which is relatively thin because it can leverage all the layers below, and it implements the actual file system with POSIX semantics. And these are exposed through the traditional VNode interface to the kernel. So how do we do this? How are these individual layers organized? We need some key techniques, which should be familiar to people who did more than one semester of computer science, but this is really important to recap that these few little key features enable most of ZFS features. So, first one, block pointers. We already had something similar with the inodes described before, but the block pointers are at a lower level. They are at the SPA level. So this is how a ZFS block pointer looks like. Don't be afraid, it's very big. This is actually, these are bits, so 64 times 16 bits is 128 bytes. So a bold statement, one could say. And we should think about what we can see here. So a block pointer points to another block of ZFS storage. And maybe the first thing that comes to mind is, well, where is the pointing data stored here, so to say? what do we see? We see a reference or field that is designated for a virtual device. We'll see about this later on. And what else do we see? Well, an offset, a very big offset actually, 63 bits. That's a lot. And we have 3 times this much. I'm sorry, I didn't move the mouse to the right screen. So 3 times 63-bit pointers, big address for VDEVs. We can point to a lot of storage here. Sorry for this one. What else do we have? Some birth times. This, we'll come to this later on, but this block pointer in itself carries to which transaction group or to which checkpoint of the file system it belongs to. And this is a very important feature for snapshots. A checksum, these are 256 bits for a single checksum. And this is the checksum of the block that this pointer points to. And I think this is all we need for now, because with these pointers, we can build something, a common data structure, which is a tree of block pointers. And the idea is to have a root of the tree and point to lists of block pointers, and each individual block pointer in the list points to another block. And this continues until you get to the leaves of the tree where actual data is kept. And you might already realize that with the block-level checksumming we have in the block, we can implement a recursive data integrity check on this tree. So if we walk the tree from top to bottom, and each time before we do anything with a block that we just, with a block reference we just dereferenced, we check the contents of the data we read from disk, validate that the checksum of the data we read from disk matches the checksum we had in our block pointer. And if this checksum matches, we know we read the correct data. If the checksum doesn't match, it means that either the checksum was corrupted or the block was corrupted, and we can report this error to the upper layers. So we won't have silent bit flips anymore. And since all this happens in the lowermost layer of ZFS, the storage pool allocator, all the above layers building up on the SPA benefit from this feature. So solve this problem once, solve it right, and you benefit from it a lot in the upper layers, and you don't have to worry about it. So block-level checksumming, we talked about this. Final thing that realizes the on-disk consistency in ZFS is the copy-on-write approach. Copy-on-write is fairly simple and is again an idea stolen from virtual memory, so to say, but it's a very good idea actually. So what we have is this tree of data of block pointers on the disk. And let's think about what happens when we modify a block of data. We have some invariants, or one particular invariant in the block, which is the checksum. And when we modify a block, and we do not want to violate the invariant, we need to actually write a copy of the block somewhere else where it's free space. Because if we modified the original block, then the tree would contain, or then when walking the tree, we would read invalid data. So we copy a new block and put it somewhere where we have free space. Well, the checksum of the data changes, so we need to copy the first level of indirection upwards and compute the new checksum, put the checksum in the copy, write the copy. And as you can see, only the leftmost block, it still points to the original data block that was leftmost, but the right block, it points to the copy. And we ripple this changes up the tree until we reach the root of the tree. And well, what do we do there? It's this block pointer is called the überblock in ZFS, and we override it in place. And this, the asterisk is there, because of course we don't overwrite it in place. That would be terribly stupid, because if we lost power in the middle of the write, then all the data integrity features we want to build are destroyed, basically. So in ZFS, we do a ring buffer approach, so to say. And we also spread the block over different parts of the disk. So this approach is similar to the traditional file system headers. Okay, so with these basic ideas, we can walk through the modules that make up ZFS. And I hope I don't scare you with a big diagram. But I think when looking at it in a bit more detail, it's actually fairly simple. In particular, what you should see is this straight line. We already walked that once when we talked about the layering in the beginning. So we have the kernel device driver, we have the SPA, I'm sorry, this should be an A, group. It actually splits up into two layers, but for now, let's say we have the storage pool allocator here. We have the ARC, which is a cache in between. We have the DMU. We have the ZPL, so the file system implementation. This is actually not part of the ZFS, but this is the what was described VNode interface earlier. It's basically how the operating system resolves a particular path to an actual file system, because you can have different file systems in an operating system. And then finally, we have the syscall boundary, userland, read or write calls. So this line should be more or less familiar to you by now. But the other ones, there are some ZWOS, we already talked about this, but the other ones, we should have a look at these. And actually, we should have a look at the individual modules in a bit more detail. So VDEVs, what are VDEVs? Virtual devices, and the storage pool allocator stripes its set of root VDEVs. So come to that later on. So the SPA will spread writes to the pool to all root VDEVs assigned to it. And a VDEV implements the access to the actual physical storage and also disk redundancy features. And we come to these in a moment. And to realize many different kinds of setups, we use a building block approach. And I hope you can see this. I think it's large enough. You can compose VDEVs to a tree of VDEVs. So you might mirror, your situation might be you might have 100 gigabyte disk and 250 gigabyte disks, and you want to somehow achieve redundancy. It would be relatively hard with traditional volume management. But in ZFS, you will just create a mirror that is composed of one disk and composed of a stripe of two disks. And I think it's fairly very intuitive interface, actually. And with very few building blocks, you can realize a lot of different setups. And these are actually the finelines where the individual VDEVs are implemented. And you can see we have disk devices. So this is basically a direct adapter to the kernel interface for the block device. Geom, this is a FreeBSD-specific thing. You can have file-backed VDEVs, which is very convenient when you are learning ZFS, and we'll use that later on. You can have cache VDEVs, so for example, the read cache in the ARC is implemented with this feature. And you can have data redundancy, disk redundancy through mirrors or RAID-Z. I read about this. You can have traditional mirroring and striping inside. This is a very fast approach and suitable, or you can get to very large IOPS, maximum IOPS using this approach. On the other hand, if you want to make the most of your storage available, then you might go for a RAID Z1 or RAID Z2, depending on your redundancy needs. So RAID Z1 is a little bit like a RAID 3 or 5, but with logical blocks and without the traditional problem that comes with RAID 3 or 5, and in this case RAID 5, the write tool, where in the middle of a write to to the rate power dies, and the rate doesn't have any way to decide, well, the checksum of the or my parity doesn't match the data, what should I do? The rate doesn't know about this because it doesn't know about the semantics of the bytes it stores. So with a more integrated approach like ZFS, where the individual layers know a little bit more about each other, we can circumvent this write rule. And if you want to have two or three disk redundancy, then you just pick rate two or three. And there's works on rate n, but so far this has not landed. And finally, you can have very fast resilvering times if your pool is not very full, because if the volume manager or the SPA actually knows about the on-disk structure, then in a resilvering process where one disk died and you replaced it with another, you only have to replicate the actual bytes containing semantics and data, or metadata and data, not like a rate just stupidly copying all blocks because it doesn't know better. So the storage pool allocator implements checksumming, compression, block level deduplication, disk redundancy, and DIO orchestration. And this, I think, makes a lot of sense because checksumming has to be implemented at this level, or it would be stupid not to. Compression, since the design goal is to have block-based compression because everything else would be more complicated, also makes sense to do it at this layer. So even metadata is compressed because metadata is kept in the upper parts of the, or ZFS metadata is contained in the upper layers of ZFS. Block level deduplication in the deduplication table is also realized at this layer. And well, finally we expose all these abstractions through an interface similar to virtual memory, so to heap memory. So we just ask the SPA for storage of certain size, and we allocate appropriate storage and distribute it according to our VDEV configuration. So with this all done, we should have a look at the DMU again. So we already talked about this. We have the DMU interface are objects and offsets into these objects. The term object is a little bit irritating because it has little to do with object-oriented programming or anything like this. Think about it as flat files that are addressable through an offset. So you just, when interfacing with the DMU, you just address I want byte XYZ at I want the byte at offset 1 megabyte, and I get that. The objects organized by the DMU are kept in private namespaces called object sets or data sets. There are cross references possible, but these are only realized by the DMU. It's not possible to realize another object set from the upper layers, from the DMU. And as already told you, the transaction interface is also implemented here. So in code, what this would look like, and this is an extract from a header file of the DMU, you would create a new transaction, then maybe perform some operations like a write on the object set on object address through a 64-bit integer at offset write the contents of buffer at of this size to the object, and the DMU will just realize this as soon as you call DMU TX commit. And which TX should we use? Which transaction? This one. So as soon as the transaction is committed, it's grouped by the DMU, and after a certain amount of transaction has been collected, the transactions are committed to disk through a single checkpoint, as described with this rippling tree schema, this copy on write ripple tree schema. So next up, actually a very simple layer, the data set and snapshot layer, because the DMU is used for many, many different purposes. As you might see from all the arrows pointing to here, it's really used by a lot of different modules. So what we need is some kind of meta layer to organize the individual object sets. And this is done in the data set and snapshot layer. So we have file systems in there, zvols in there, snapshots of file systems or zvols, clones, and maybe someday there will be an interface that a database application, for example, can directly use the DMU instead of walking all the crazy stuff through file system, implementing the transaction safety itself, and so on. There are plans for this, but so far not realized. But since we have so many different types of access to the DMU, we need a container and for these object sets, and the name people came up with is meta object set. So don't be afraid. this is an excerpt from a talk given by Kirk McCusick. You have one Uber block pointing into the meta object set layer. So you have the root of the meta object set containing maybe a file system, zvols, clones, some additional metadata, space map. I won't go into detail on this one. And each individual one of these meta object set data structures references an object set where it organizes itself appropriately. And all these object sets are concerned of the DMU, and these ones are mostly concerned to the data set and snapshot layer. And I think this is fairly straightforward. Now, the thing I have omitted, the adaptive replacement cache, the L2 arc. So this one, the arc and the L2 arc. Of course, you can imagine with all these layers of indirection, if we did synchronous disk access all the time, for each individual dereference, ZFS would be terribly slow. And the most elegant solution people came up with is feed it with a lot of RAM. That's basically what you have to do. Because if you keep much of the metadata structures in memory, then you can resolve these indirections very quickly, and then only access the disk for actual data. So the ARC is the adaptive replacement cache. It is physically indexed, so not indexed by DMU object IDs or something, but it is really in just above the SPA. So yeah, utility of the cache is somehow maximized. And the eviction strategy has to be adjusted a little, because well, if you use traditional least recently used eviction, then streaming a movie off the disk would evict the entire cache. So what you do is you implement a strategy combining most recently used and most frequently used lists, and also tracking which blocks were just evicted from the cache in so-called ghost list. And read it up in Wikipedia if you want. It's originally invented at IBM, I think. Very interesting approach, and it solves specifically the problem you have when implementing file system. Important to know, because the ARC is so tightly integrated into ZFS, and it's also very tightly integrated with the L2 ARC, naturally, it's separate from the system page cache. So, for example, memory maps, which can be optimized if you have a traditional file system utilizing the system page cache, memory maps are naturally more expensive because there are two copies in memory. And you can configure it, but in the default configuration, the ARC will consume much of your system memory. I think default is half of your system memory and some minimum value. So you might consider tuning this variable. But in general, the more RAM you feed it, the better. And finally, the L2 ARC, just basically a side note, also the implementation is a little more complicated. If your memory does not suffice, or for example, you have a pool consisting only of HDDs, then you can use an SSD to speed up read operations by caching additional data on the SSD as well as in RAM. And ZFS support for this integrated. very easy to set up. So with these basics or these lower layers all done, we can think about how the user-facing features of ZFS are implemented. So in particular, the ZFS POSIX layer is described here. As we already know, it implements file systems with POSIX semantics. And to do this, it heavily leverages the DMU and the ZAP and the ZIL. What these mean, we'll come to in a second. But I think from an engineering perspective, it's a very beautiful thing that you can implement a file system with very few lines of code because you build up some proper abstractions below. So the ZFS attribute processor, the ZIP, is heavily leveraged by the ZFS POSIX layer, but also all over the place over ZFS, because what it realizes is the most basic data structure, you have key value pair data structures. So it's nestable, so you can represent complex data inside, and it's used to store the metadata of individual files in the ZPL layer. It's used to store directories also in the ZPL layer, and there are special algorithms and data structures inside to speed up directory lookups. Dataset attributes like the mount point, stuff like this, is all stored inside there and used internally in ZFS. And pool attributes are also stored using this layer. So it's really a really general purpose layer providing infrastructure to other modules. And the ZIL may be worth mentioning. This tree copy and write structure I talked about in the beginning, rippling up from a data leaf to the überblock and creating a new transaction on disk, transaction group on a checkpoint on disk for every single POSIX operation that is meant to be synchronous and shall ensure consistency, like for example an fsync. It's just not feasible to do this with DMU checkpoints because they are too heavyweight, because there are applications that do fsyncs every few hundred milliseconds. So you really don't want to take a checkpoint every time. And the solution the ZFS developers came up with is implement some sort of journaling, but implement it in the semantics of the ZPL and ZWords, because that's really the only place where this is needed. So the ZPL will record write to DMU objects X at offset XYZ and then contain the modification in a separate block. So this block can be used later on to integrate into the tree structure. And like with the L2 arc, you can designate a specific VDEV to be the ZIL. And although I don't use it personally, many people use NVRAM or SSDs to speed up their write IO operations with this, because it's intuitively, if you put this ZIL to every POSIX syscall that like fsync, this would become a bottleneck in your pool, and you have to prepare against this somehow. But it's only, the ZIL is very small. You don't need much space for this. So how it works is operations are queued up until enough change is collected or enough time has elapsed. And then the changes in the ZIL or accumulated in the ZIL are integrated into a transaction group. So nothing to really worry about as during daily use, but if you encounter performance problems, this might be a way to solve this. Finally, some specialties of ZFS, the ZVoids, short, they also leverage the DMU, and basically a ZVol is a block device. What does the DMU do? It exposes objects with offsets. Block devices are also addressable through offsets. So implementing ZVoids is really a matter of a few hundred lines of code. And what do you get with this? You get all the data integrity features as described earlier, you can export these C-voids via iSCSI, or you can use them as local or remote VM storage. Very convenient. Okay, the management of all the ZFS configuration is mostly done through dev ZFS. So the two user land utilities, zpool and ZFS, issue IOCDL calls to dev ZFS, and dev ZFS acts accordingly. You can configure the VDEVs, and this device is also used to send or receive snapshot streams. It's just call an IOCDL call to dev ZFS, and then you get the snapshot bytes out of it. So this was the walkthrough through the ZFS modules. And to recap all this, or do you need a recap? Because otherwise we can give more live demos. Maybe raise your hand if you want a walkthrough through the individual modules again, or whether you directly want to see ZFS in action, how it actually looks on the command line. So option one, please raise your hand. Option two, please. Oh, okay. Okay.
Maybe an interesting, if you have really performance problems, and how you can really, which responsibility you have to look where the problems really come from.
Okay. I will go into that later in the question section because it's a fairly specific issue. Okay. So we will skip this example and directly jump to how ZFS looks in action. And I
have a question.
Yeah.
Will you talk about the necessity or that you don't need ECC run? Because maybe if you look about ZFS on the internet, you read, yes, it comes from Solaris. Use ECC run or everything will burn.
Okay, so I repeat the question. Question was whether ECC run or not. I think this is a discussion that really exceeds just the ZFS community, and it becomes religious very fast. I don't have the experience in data center operation to give any detailed comments on this. I use ECC RAM in my personal storage machine, but I don't think I'm qualified to give any statistically founded hints about this. Okay, so ZFS in action. I will reconfigure. Need to reconfigure my screen so I can mirror it to you. You can see, yeah. Okay, so what we'll do is we create a few sparse files, which will represent the disks in our pool. So what we do is we create six drives, six sparse files, each 100 megabytes, and we create them in the temp directory. So now we have these files in the temp directory. Next, we create the zpool. And because this is Linux, I have to use sudo, because on Linux, ZFS does not work with ZFS user delegation, does not work in ZFS on Linux right now. So we create a new pool called tank, which is a RAID Z of disk 0, disk 1, disk 2, and we maybe want a spare disk 3. So, and I opened GNU Watch on the right side. I the font big enough? Yes, I think so. So you see an overview of how the Z-pool is architected.
Maybe a question right at this point, how clever is that storage level? Can I use different sizes and then build clever use level? Do I have to use equally sized pairs of disks?
Okay, so the question was whether the individual disks have to be equally sized. I think it will, if you feed it with different disks or partitions, it will choose the minimum if you have mirror configuration. And I think for it set 2, because you need to spread the parity so you can always guarantee that one disk can fail and you have the data. However, there are auto-expanding features in Zpool. It's basically a property you can set. But the basic idea is that you feed it with equal sized disks, and if you want to grow the pool later on, you will buy new drives, put them in a separate device, connect them to the server or your machine where ZFS is running, and then grow the pool and remove the old disks later on. Okay. So we created the pool, and maybe we put some data inside. So what I would suggest is we write a bunch of zeros to the pool. Before we do this, we might want to look where the pool is actually mounted. So through ZFS list tank, and we see tank has used data, some available storage, and the mount point is at /tank. You might ask why this is so little available storage. Because 100 megabyte disks, I think we are past this nowadays. There is some metadata that is stored in the disk. I assure that you won't pay a penalty of half the storage if you have 4 terabyte drives or something. This is really because of the demo right now, and because the files are so small. So we have a file system mounted at tank, and we create a file there containing lots of zeros. So we use the DD tool for this, tank zeros, and we create a 100 megabyte file. Yes, so because all file systems default to being owned by root, to do this is root 2. So in tank we have a 100 megabyte file containing all zeros. Fine. So what happens now if one disk in the pool has corrupted data? And because we have files, it is easy to simulate data corruption by using DD again, but this time writing some random bytes into the disk file, which is basically data corruption. So we will use the view random. In this case, we will actually also corrupt the ZFS headers, so the entire drive will be marked as defective. So I am sorry that I just blanked the entire screen. I hope you remember the context a little. We write random bytes to disk zero. Let's make a drastic example. Say 50 megabytes on this drive flip, and also these 50 megabytes flip in the beginning. So will this work? These are owned by the user. I think this will work. So randomness takes a little of time. So naturally, because this data corruption happened silently, ZFS doesn't know about this. How should it? The disk would need to inform ZFS that bits flipped and that disk isn't that clever. So what you usually do is you either access a particular file on the pool, and because ZFS in the proceedings of the file access, as we know from the laying architecture, will walk through this tree of blocks, it will sometime encounter a checksumming error and then return an appropriate error through the syscall to the user. The other ability to detect errors, and I strongly encourage you to do this if you use ZFS in your personal setups, is to do periodic ZFS scrubs. Scrubs are basically command to ZFS that it shall walk its entire on-disk data structure and verify all the checksums. So it's just walking the entire tree and verifying checksums. And we will tell ZFS to do the latter one. So we tell the zpool to scrub all its data on this data, and refresh time is 5 seconds. We should see corrupted data now. Okay, well, we got that. So maybe I can increase the font size a little. So what do we see here? Pool tank is degraded. We get a very nice status information. Actually, ZFS status information is mostly usable, and these URLs actually contain useful information. And disk zero, where we just put the random bytes, is marked as unavailable, and data is corrupted there. Well, luckily we have a RAID, so the pool is only degraded and it will continue to serve files, possibly with lower IOPS, because it has to reconstruct the data each time. But we are still operational. However, we might want to fix this particular problem. So we will replace the faulty disk zero with our spare disk three. And to do this, we issue the replace command as also described above here. Zpool replace, we pick the pool, which is tank, and we replace the device disk zero with the spare disk three. Again, let's wait for GNU Watch to update itself. This will, okay, and what have we seen here? We see the spare, so we have currently added a spare for disk zero, and ZFS told us that that it received 50 megabytes of data. So basically, we overwrote 50 megabytes of data, and these were corrected again. And since we now determine that disk zero is permanently defect, we can as well detach it from the pool, and it will disappear. So and now we have a fully operational pool. Finally, we can clear all the error messages we got from tank. And now the scan, okay, the scan data lasts. Okay, but otherwise, if an error occurs that you will ignore for a second, then you can also clear the messages. Also interesting, you can display the history of commands that were applied to the pool. So you can exactly follow how the pool was created, which operations were performed at which particular point in time, which disks were replaced. Very convenient feature. So now that we have set up the pool correctly and replaced the one faulty disk, maybe we can look at how the interface of ZFS looks like. It's similar and similarly intuitive. Okay, we have a question.
Could we have used any other disk to replace the failed one, or must it be a spare disk?
No, you can attach additional spares afterwards. The spare is basically meant as to hop around between different pools. It's, from what I know, mostly a convenience feature. Maybe heavier ZFS users can report on this differently, but you could just as well add another disk to the pool and then use that one. Yes?
Could the spare disk for the ZFS management, even the ZFS key, it's basically designated disks that the system is allowed to automatically use.
Yeah.
For the disks.
repeat that again, it was follow-up to the question. So you can can either use ZFSD, or I think in more recent implementations, there's also the auto-replace feature on the ZPool that you can turn on, that they can enable. And this will automatically replace failing drives. Yes? Other question?
Can you repair a pool without replacing the drive?
The question is whether you can repair a pool without replacing the drive. It's self-healing. So as long as there is the ability to do repairs without replacing a drive, then yes, the pool will self-heal and automatically deliver correct data. So for example, while the pool was in degraded state, it would have still answered I/O operations correctly. It would have still delivered data that you want to read.
Why didn't you just repair itself? The data was corrupt, the drive itself was okay. It should have repaired.
Okay, in this particular, okay. So the question was, in this particular case, yes, it was a non-optimal example because there was not just a single bit flip in some of the data structures, but I actually destroyed the Uber block, the part where the Uber block is stored, and this renders permanently damaged pool, and this has to happen automatically. Yeah. Question? Yeah.
So, but what if, for example, in a real system, the Uber block would have been misread because, for example, a faulty cable, and I replace the cable and the disk is still okay? Could I tell ZFS to just restore the drive from what it has left?
Yes. For example, if a cable breaks or something, the on-disk structure is still present, and with the birth time in the block pointer, and also the birth time in the Uber block, a disk it reattached after it was detached from the pool for a while would just need to be resilvered from, or would just need to receive the changes from where it was detached to the current state of the pool. And ZFS does this automatically. Another question?
Yeah, could it have also just made the whole pool smaller and used the two remaining disks? I mean, it knows if space is used, so it could perhaps.
Yeah, the question is whether you could make the pool smaller by just removing one disk. Yes, you could do that, but you lose the redundancy. So. Depends. I also did some hacks with one disk redundancy, then removing the disk to attach it to a new pool, because you don't always have spare disks available to create a new pool. You see, this is really meant for huge scale operations, and with the big block pointers that you have seen, ZFS is really meant to address a lot of data. The data structures inside there are up to zettabytes theoretically. So this is the expanded name of the file system. So, and where you are storing these huge amounts of data, a few disks are not that big of a problem. So it's a little enterprisey.
Earlier, you mentioned the automatic deduplication of data. How much is actually used by the 10 megabytes of zeros?
Okay, automatic deduplication. And the question was whether the 100 megabytes of zeros, how much they actually occupy on disk. In this pool, I did not enable deduplication because the deduplication feature actually uses a lot of more RAM than just the ARC, which also uses a lot of RAM. So, because you can imagine how deduplication works. You use the checksum as an index into the deduplication table, and you just check, well, before you write the node to disk, the block to disk, well, this checksum, have I already written it? And if so, then you already only store that your reference to the original block on disk. So this feature is not enabled on the pool. However, if I enabled compression on the file system where this pool is stored, so if I enabled compression on this pool, on this data set, then the 100 megabytes of zeros would have been a few bytes. Essentially, the metadata, I think the metadata one level up, up the actual data wouldn't have been. So compression looks like, enabling compression is very simple operation. If you want to specify the algorithm, you could, for example, use gzip at its various gzip at its various levels, or the default, which is when you just turn the flag on, is LZ4 or LZJP, which is a stream compression algorithm, and it's specifically designed for use in ZFS. Any more questions on this one? Because otherwise, I would continue with individual dataset features. Yes, question.
When you enable it afterwards, does it compress all the files on it?
No, it's append-only compression, so to say. So everything, every block afterwards, will be touched again. An argument why this does not happen, that you recompress everything when you enable the feature. On the one hand, you can't really estimate how long it. You could estimate how long it takes, but for this instance, it would produce a lot of I/O load, and you would create a lot of new transactions at the same time. So it's append only. So if you want to convert a data set with a lot of data to be compressed, then you would create a new data set and then send a snapshot of the uncompressed data set to the compressed data set, but not apply the compression setting of the old data set to the new data set. It's very easy, and this is the way to do it. Other questions? Okay. So maybe we can get a more complete picture of the individual data set properties. Really a lot. So ZFS get always gets you the properties of a data set. Zpool get gets you the properties of a zpool. So for the data set tank, well, we get, this is a file system. It was created at this particular date. You get some basic statistics. These are actually fairly tricky, and this is due to the copy and write semantics of ZFS. I always have to look up the man page to exactly determine what amount of data is used by which kind of blocks. Because if I took a snapshot, how do I account the storage, that the delta from the snapshot to my current state of the file system? How do I account it?
This is also a common problem with links as ZFS, and especially df-h is really unreliable with ZFS. Is it also hard in ZFS to determine how much free space I have left?
There's the remark on in particular on how df-h integrates with this. In short, I don't use df-h for this. I use zpool get, but at least you should see it in my i3 bar here. I think this is report. I don't know if it's reported by the file system or by DF. I would have to look it up. But my machine runs on root ZFS. Yeah, remark.
Reporting of free disk space in ZFS is very, very accurate in comparison, if you compare it to butterfs or beta.
Okay, so the remark from the audience: the storage reports from ZFS are apparently more accurate than in butterfs. But
there's some kind of background story, but it's wrong because they have experimented their unit tests on very small tiles, and they wanted to have it very accurate, and then the counting was made very accurate, so they have everything correct.
Okay. Well, let's walk through them because some are actually very interesting. So here are the quota and reservation features I talked about earlier. So you would actually set these properties per data set. So, and maybe because I know we are a little bit short on time. All the data sets I'm talking about, you have not really seen them yet, because the flexibility to create new file systems basically looks like this. So I want to create another file system inside the tank pool. And ZFS uses a URL notation for this. So for example, I want to create a logs file system. And I just make this hit this command. And let me show recursively all the data sets of the tank data set. And you see, now it's not just the tank data set, but also a child, which shares the same amount of storage, the same pool of storage. And this is really convenient because, for example, I could create another data set called movies. I list it again, and I have all these different file systems, and to the operating system, these look like different file systems, and I can set all the individual properties we saw before on them. So for example, for the logs, I know logs are easily compressible, so I set it to gzip -9, because computation is cheap, and this just happens, and I know that all logs written to the tank logs directory, all data written to the tank logs directory again, will be compressed using gzip 9, saving lots of space. In contrast, I could increase the block size of the movies data set to consume less data. And on systems other than Linux, so for example on FreeBSD, which I use on servers, you have all the delegation features available to you. So you could designate a data set to a jail, and all this is also handled by the ZFS utility. We are, I think time is up. I would be willing to accept more questions if there is no consecutive event in this room. Okay. Other question?
Yes, I have read that ZFS on Solaris supports encryption. How does encryption integrate with all the rest of ZFS? Have you seen how it is implemented?
Okay, so the encryption topic, maybe this is a good closing point. So ZFS was originally developed at Sun, and the release, and Sun decided to open source it with OpenSolaris. Sun was bought by Oracle, and the version of ZFS that would have been released just after Oracle bought Sun actually contains encryption. And so the commercial version of ZFS supports encryption. The open ZFS implementation on most platforms doesn't so far. However, the infrastructure for this is in place, and the most natural fit for this will probably be the storage pool allocator. And I think there is one implementation that is fairly recent where it's implemented there. However, there is big discussion among the development community how to implement this property, and not necessarily regarding the actual crypto implementation, but more of the key management implementation, because many operating systems actually boot off ZFS, and you would have to integrate all this as well.
So Oracle doesn't share this source anymore?
No, Oracle doesn't. Doesn't share this. Okay, I think time is up. We can talk later on. And thank you for your time.